Section 3 of Celebrated Crimes, Volume 4, Part 1, Karl Ludwig Zand by Alexandre Dumas, translated by George Burnham Ives. When, on the 26th of March, the news of Kotzebue's assassination came from Mannheim to Jena, the Academic Senate caused Zand's room to be opened and found two letters. One addressed to his friends of the Burschenschaft, in which he declared that he no longer belonged to their society, since he did not wish that their brotherhood should include a man about to die on the scaffold. The other letter, which bore this superscription, "To my nearest and dearest," was an exact account of what he meant to do, and the motives which had made him determine upon this act. Though the letter is a little long, it is so solemn and so antique in spirit that we do not hesitate to present it in its entirety to our readers. "To all my own loyal and eternally cherished souls, why add still further to your sadness? I asked myself, and I hesitated to write to you, but my silence would have wounded the religion of the heart, and the deeper a grief, the more it needs, before it can be blotted out, to drain to the dregs its cup of bitterness. Forth from my agonized breast, then, forth long and cruel torment of a last conversation, which alone, however, when sincere, can alleviate the pain of parting. This letter brings you the last farewell of your son and your brother. The greatest misfortune of life for any generous heart is to see the cause of God stopped short in its developments by our fault, and the most dishonouring infamy would be to suffer that the fine things acquired bravely by thousands of men, and for which thousands of men have joyfully sacrificed themselves, should be no more than a transient dream, without real and positive consequences. The resurrection of our German life was begun in these last 20 years, and particularly in the sacred year 1813, with a courage inspired by God. But now the house of our fathers is shaken from the summit to the base. Forward, let us raise it new and fair, and such as the true temple of the true God should be. Small is the number of those who resist and who wish to oppose themselves as a dike against the torrent of the progress of higher humanity among the German people. Why should vast whole masses bow beneath the yoke of a perverse minority? And why, scarcely healed, should we fall back into a worse disease than that which we are leaving behind? Many of these seducers, and those who are the most infamous, are playing the game of corruption with us. Among them is Kotzebue, the most cunning and the worst of all, a real talking machine emitting all sorts of detestable speech and pernicious advice. His voice is skillful in removing from us all anger and bitterness against the most unjust measures, and is just such as kings require to put us to sleep again in that old hazy slumber which is the death of nations. Every day he odiously betrays his country, and nevertheless, despite his treason, remains an idol for half Germany, which, dazzled by him, accepts unresisting the poison poured out by him in this periodic pamphlets, wrapped up and protected as he is by the seductive mantle of a great poetic reputation. Incited by him, the princes of Germany, who have forgotten their promises, will allow nothing free or good to be accomplished. Or if anything of the kind is accomplished in spite of them, they will league themselves with the French to annihilate it. That the history of our time may not be covered with eternal ignominy, it is necessary that he should fall. I have always said that if we wish to find a great and supreme remedy for the state of abasement in which we are, none must shrink from combat nor from suffering, and the real liberty of the German people will only be assured when the good citizen sets himself or some other stake upon the game, and when every true son of the country, prepared for the struggle for justice, despises the good things of this world, and only desires those celestial good things which death holds in charge. Who then will strike this miserable hireling, this venal traitor? I have long been waiting in fear and prayer and in tears, I who am not born for murder, for some other to be beforehand with me, to set me free and suffer me to continue my way along the sweet and peaceful path that I have chosen for myself. Well, despite my prayers and my tears, he who should strike does not present himself. Indeed, every man, like myself, has a right to count upon some other, and everyone thus counting every hour's delay but makes our state worse. For at any moment, and how deep a shame would that be for us, Kotzebue may leave Germany unpunished and go to devour in Russia the treasures for which he has exchanged his honour, his conscience, and his German name. Who can preserve us from this shame, if every man, if I myself, do not feel strength to make myself the chosen instrument of God's justice? Therefore, forward! It shall be I who will courageously rush upon him. Do not be alarmed. On him, the loathsome seducer. It shall be I who will kill the traitor, so that his misguiding voice, being extinguished, shall cease to lead us astray from the lessons of history and from the spirit of God. An irresistible and solemn duty impels me to this deed, ever since I have recognized to what high destinies the German nation may attain during this century, and ever since I have come to know the dastard and the hypocrite who alone prevents it from reaching them. For me, as for every German who seeks the public good, this desire has become a strict and binding necessity. May I, by this national vengeance, indicate to all upright and loyal consciences where the true danger lies, and save our vilified and calumniated societies from the imminent danger that threatens them. May I, in short, spread terror among the cowardly and wicked, and courage and faith among the good. Speeches and writings lead to nothing, only actions work. I will act, therefore, and though driven violently away from my fair dreams of the future, I am none the less full of trust in God. I even experience a celestial joy now that, like the Hebrews when they sought the Promised Land, I see traced before me, through darkness and death, that road at the end of which I shall have paid my debt to my country. Farewell, then, faithful hearts. True, this early separation is hard. True, your hopes, like my wishes, are disappointed. But let us be consoled by the primary thought that we have done what the voice of our country called upon us to do. That, you knew, is the principle according to which I have always lived. You will doubtless say among yourselves, yes, thanks to our sacrifices he had learned to know life and to taste the joys of earth, and he seemed deeply to love his native country and the humble estate to which he was called. Alas, yes, that is true. Under your protection and amid your numberless sacrifices, my native land and life had become profoundly dear to me. Yes, thanks to you, I have penetrated into the Eden of knowledge, and have lived the free life of thought. Thanks to you, I have looked into history, and have then returned to my own conscience to attach myself to the solid pillars of faith in the eternal. Yes, I was to pass gently through this life as a preacher of the gospel. Yes, in my constancy to my calling, I was to be sheltered from the storms of this existence. But would that suffice to avert the danger that threatens Germany? And you yourselves, in your infinite love, should you not rather push me on to risk my life for the good of all? So many modern Greeks have fallen already to free their country from the yoke of the Turks, and have died almost without any result and without any hope. And yet thousands of fresh martyrs keep up their courage and are ready to fall in their turn. And should I, then, hesitate to die? That I do not recognize your love, or that your love is but a trifling consideration with me, you will not believe. What else should impel me to die, if not my devotion to you and to Germany, and the need of proving this devotion to my family and my country? You, mother, will say, why have I brought up a son whom I loved and who loved me, for whom I have undergone 1,000 cares and toils, who, thanks to my prayers and my example, was impressionable to good influences, and from whom, after my long and weary course, I hope to receive attentions like those which I have given him. Why does he now abandon me? Oh, my kind and tender mother. Yes, you will perhaps say that, but could not the mother of anyone else say the same, and everything go off thus in words when there is need to act for the country? And if no one would act, what would become of that mother of us all who is called Germany? But no, such complaints are far from you, you noble woman. I understood your appeal once before, and at this present hour, if no one came forward in the German cause, you yourself would urge me to the fight. I have 2 brothers and 2 sisters before me, all noble and loyal. They will remain to you, mother, and besides, you will have for sons all the children of Germany who love their country. Every man has a destiny which he has to accomplish. Mine is devoted to the action that I am about to undertake. If I were to live another 50 years, I could not live more happily than I have done lately. Farewell, mother. I commend you to the protection of God. May he raise you to that joy which misfortunes can no longer trouble. Take your grandchildren, to whom I should so much have liked to be a loving friend, to the top of our beautiful mountains soon. There, on that altar raised by the Lord himself in the midst of Germany, let them devote themselves, swearing to take up the sword as soon as they have strength to lift it, and to lay it down only when our brethren are all united in liberty, when all Germans, having a liberal constitution, are great before the Lord, powerful against their neighbors, and united among themselves. May my country ever raise her happy gaze to thee, Almighty Father. May thy blessing fall abundantly upon her harvests, ready to be cut, and her armies ready for battle. And recognizing the blessings that thou hast showered upon us, may the German nation ever be first among nations to rise and uphold the cause of humanity, which is thy image upon earth. Your eternally attached son, brother, and friend, Karl-Ludwig Zand, Jena, the beginning of March, 1819. Alexandre, who we have said had at first been taken to the hospital, was removed at the end of 3 months to the prison at Mannheim, where the governor, Mr. G, had caused a room to be prepared for him. There he remained 2 months longer in a state of extreme weakness. His left arm was completely paralyzed, his voice was very weak, every movement gave him horrible pain, and thus it was not until the 11th of August, that is to say, 5 months after the event that we have narrated, that he was able to write to his family the following letter.
"My very dear parents, the Grand Duke's commission of inquiry informed me yesterday that it might be possible I should have the intense joy of a visit from you, and that I might perhaps see you here and embrace you, you, mother, and some of my brothers and sisters. Without being surprised at this fresh proof of your motherly love, I have felt an ardent remembrance reawaken of the happy life that we spent gently together. Joy and grief, desire and sacrifice, agitate my heart violently, and I have had to weigh these various impulses one against the other, and with the force of reason, in order to resume mastery of myself, and to take a decision in regard to my wishes. The balance has inclined in the direction of sacrifice. You know, mother, how much joy and courage look from your eyes, a daily intercourse with you and your pious and high-minded conversation might bring me during my very short time. But you also know my position, and you are too well acquainted with the natural course of all these painful inquiries not to feel as I do that such annoyance, continually recurring, would greatly trouble the pleasure of our companionship if it did not indeed succeed in entirely destroying it. Then, mother, after the long and fatiguing journey that you would be obliged to make in order to see me, I think of the terrible sorrow of the farewell when the moment came to part in this world. Let us therefore abide by the sacrifice, according to God's will, and let us yield ourselves only to that sweet community of thought which distance cannot interrupt, in which I find my only joys, and which, in spite of men, will always be granted us by the Lord our Father. As for my physical state, I knew nothing about it. You see, however, since at last I am writing to you myself, that I have come past my first uncertainties. As for the rest, I know too little of the structure of my own body to give any opinion as to what my wounds may determine for it, except that a little strength has returned to me, its state is still the same, and I endure it calmly and patiently. For God comes to my help and gives me courage and firmness. He will help me, believe me, to find all the joys of the soul and to be strong in mind. Amen. May you live happy. Your deeply respectful son, Karl-Ludwig Zand."
A moment after this letter came tender answers from all the family. We will quote only that of Zand's mother, because it completes the idea which the reader may have formed already of this great-hearted woman, as her son always calls her.
"Dear, inexpressibly dear Karl, how sweet it was to me to see the writing of your beloved hand after so long a time. No journey would have been so painful and no road so long as to prevent me from coming to you, and I would go in deep and infinite love to any end of the earth by the mere hope of catching sight of you. But, as I well know both your tender affection and your profound anxiety for me, and as you give me so firmly and upon such manly reflection, reasons against which I can say nothing, and which I can but honour, it shall be, my well-beloved Karl, as you have wished and decided. We will continue without speech to communicate our thoughts, but be satisfied, nothing can separate us. I enfold you in my soul, and my material thoughts watch over you. May this infinite love which upholds us, strengthens us, and leads us all to a better life, preserve, dear Karl, your courage and firmness. Farewell, and be invariably assured that I shall never cease to love you strongly and deeply. Your faithful mother, who loves you to eternity."
Zand replied, on January 1820, from an isle of Patmos,
"My dear parents, brothers and sisters, in the midst of the month of September last year, I received, through the Grand Duke's special commission of inquiry, whose humanity you have already appreciated, your dear letters of the end of August and beginning of September, which had such magical influence that they inundated me with joy by transporting me into the inmost circle of your hearts. You, my tender father, you write to me on the 67th anniversary of your birth, and you bless me by the outpouring of your most tender love. You, my well-beloved mother, you deign to promise the continuance of your maternal affection, in which I have at all times constantly believed, and thus I have received the blessings of both of you, which, in my present position, will exercise a more beneficent influence upon me than any of the things that all the kings of the earth, united together, could grant me.
Yes, you strengthen me abundantly by your blessed love, and I render thanks to you, my beloved parents, with that respectful submission that my heart will always inculcate as the first duty of a son. But the greater your love and the more affectionate your letters, the more do I suffer, I must acknowledge, from the voluntary sacrifice that we have imposed upon ourselves in not seeing one another. And the only reason, my dear parents, why I have delayed to reply to you was to give myself time to recover the strength which I have lost. You too, my dear brother-in-law and dear sister, assure me of your sincere and uninterrupted attachment. And yet, after the fright that I have spread among you all, you seem not to know exactly what to think of me. But my heart, full of gratitude for your past kindness, comforts itself, for your actions speak and tell me that, even if you wished no longer to love me as I love you, you would not be able to do otherwise. These actions mean more to me at this hour than any possible protestations, nay, than even the tenderest words. And you also, my kind brother, you would have consented to hurry with our beloved mother to the shores of the Rhine, to this place where the real links of the soul were welded between us, where we were doubly brothers. But tell me, are you not really here in thought and in spirit when I consider the rich fountain of consolation brought me by your cordial and tender letter? And you, kind sister-in-law, as you showed yourself from the first in your delicate tenderness, a true sister, so I find you again at present. There are still the same tender relations, still the same sisterly affection. Your consolations, which emanate from a deep and submissive piety, have fallen refreshingly into the depths of my heart. But, dear sister-in-law, I must tell you, as well as the others, that you are too liberal towards me in dispensing your esteem and praises, and your exaggeration has cast me back face to face with my inmost judge, who has shown me in the mirror of my conscience the image of my every weakness. You, kind Julia, you desire nothing else but to save me from the fate that awaits me, and you assure me in your own name, and in that of you all, that you, like the others, would rejoice to endure it in my place, and that I recognize you fully, and I recognize, too, those sweet and tender relations in which we have been brought up from childhood. Oh, be comforted, dear Julia. Thanks to the protection of God, I promise you that it will be easy for me, much easier than I should have thought, to bear what falls to my lot. Receive, then, all of you, my warm and sincere thanks for having thus rejoiced my heart. Now that I know from these strengthening letters that, like the prodigal son, the love and goodness of my family are greater on my return than at my departure, I will, as carefully as possible, paint for you my physical and moral state, and I pray God to supplement my words by his strength, so that my letter may contain an equivalent of what yours brought to me, and may help you to reach that state of calm and serenity to which I have myself attained. Hardened by having gained power over myself, against the good and ill of this earth, you knew already that of late years I have lived only for moral joys. And I must say that, touched by my efforts, doubtless the Lord, who is the sacred font of all that is good, has rendered me apt in seeking them and in tasting them to the full. God is ever near me as formerly, and I find in him the sovereign's principle of the creation of all things. In him, our Holy Father, not only consolation and strength, but an unalterable friend, full of the holiest love, who will accompany me in all places where I may need his consolations. Assuredly, if he had turned from me, or if I had turned away my eyes from him, I should now find myself very unfortunate and wretched. But by his grace, on the contrary, lowly and weak creature as I am, he makes me strong and powerful against whatever can befall me. What I have hitherto revered as sacred, and what I have desired as good, what I have aspired to as heavenly, has in no respect changed now. And I thank God for it, for I should now be in great despair if I were compelled to recognize that my heart had adored deceptive images and enwrapped itself in fugitive chimeras. Thus, my faith in these ideas and my pure love for them, guardian angels of my spirit as they are, increase moment by moment, and will go on increasing to my end, and I hope that I may pass all the more easily from this world into eternity. I pass my silent life in Christian exaltation and humility, and I sometimes have those visions from above, through which I have, from my birth, adored heaven upon earth, and which give me power to raise myself to the Lord upon the eager wings of my prayers. My illness, though long and painful and cruel, has always been sufficiently mastered by my will to let me busy myself to some result with history, positive sciences, and the finer parts of religious education, and when my suffering became more violent and for a time interrupted these occupations, I struggled successfully nevertheless, against ennui, for the memories of the past, my resignation to the present, and my faith in the future were rich enough and strong enough in me and round me to prevent my falling from my terrestrial paradise. According to my principles, I would never, in the position in which I am and in which I have placed myself, have been willing to ask anything for my own comfort. But so much kindness and care have been lavished upon me with so much delicacy and humanity, which, alas, I am unable to return, by every person with whom I have been brought into contact, that wishes which I should not have dared to frame in my most private recesses of my heart have been more than exceeded. I have never been so much overcome by bodily pains that I could not say within myself, while I lifted my thoughts to heaven, come what may of this ray. And great as these gains have been, I could not dream of comparing them with those sufferings of the soul that we feel so profoundly and poignantly in the recognition of our weaknesses and faults. Moreover, these pains seldom now cause me to lose consciousness. The swelling and inflammation never made great headway, and the fever has always been moderate, though for nearly 10 months I have been forced to remain lying on my back, unable to raise myself, and although more than 40 pints of matter have come from my chest at the place where the heart is, no, on the contrary, the wound, though still open, is in a good state, and I owe that not only to the excellent nursing around me, but also to the pure blood that I received from you, my mother. Thus I have lacked neither earthly assistance nor heavenly encouragement. Thus, on the anniversary of my birth, I had every reason, not to curse the hour in which I was born, but on the contrary, after serious contemplation of the world, to thank God and you, my dear parents, for the life that you have given me. I celebrated it on the 18th of October by a peaceful and ardent submission to the holy will of God. On Christmas Day I tried to pull myself into the temper of children who are devoted to the Lord, and with God's help with the new year will pass like its predecessor in bodily pain, perhaps, but certainly in spiritual joy. And with this wish, the only one that I form, I address myself to you, my dear parents, and to you and yours, my dear brothers and sisters. I cannot hope to see a 25th new year, so may the prayer that I have just made be granted. May this picture of my present state afford you some tranquillity, and may this letter that I write to you from the depths of my heart not only prove to you that I am not unworthy of the inexpressible love that you all display, but on the contrary, ensure this love to me for eternity. Within the last few days I have also received your dear letter of the 2nd of December, my kind mother, and the Grand Duke's commission has deigned to let me also read my kind brother's letter which accompanied yours. You give me the best of news in regard to the health of all of you, and send me preserved fruits from our dear home. I thank you for them from the bottom of my heart. What causes me most joy in the matter is that you have been solicitously busy about me in the summer as in winter, and that you and my dear Julia gathered them and prepared them for me at home, and I abandoned my whole soul to that sweet enjoyment. I rejoice sincerely at my little cousin's coming into the world. I joyfully congratulate the good parents and the grandparents. I transport myself for his baptism into that beloved parish, where I offer him my affection as his Christian brother, and call down on him all the blessings of heaven. We shall be obliged, I think, to give up this correspondence, so as not to inconvenience the Grand Duke's commission. I finish, therefore, by assuring you once more, but for the last time, perhaps, of my profound filial submission and of my fraternal affection, your most tenderly attached, Karl-Ludwig Sand.
Indeed, from that moment, all correspondence between Karl and his family ceased, and he only wrote to them when he knew his fate. One more letter, which we shall see later on. End of section 3.